And here she is.
We're gonna do, we started and we're gonna sing this again.
Yeah,
we
started with that
kind of.
Yeah, we started.
bed, we're good.
And Jane can give you a hug.
That's right.
Okay, glory to God. Help me, Jesus. I want to apologize to you. I meant to cut off chapter 7 off of here because I was working out of last year's 2008 notes. And when I sent it out on MailChimp and, well, not on MailChimp, I will get it cut off before we send it on MailChimp. But whatever I sent to you, it got a whole bunch of chapter 6 and 7 notes on it. From 2008, I'm sorry, I meant to get it cut off. I didn't get it cut off mine, so I won't go over.
It's all good. Thanks on it, too.
Huh? She made a point blank charge, so I don't think about that making my charges, okay? United States, we pass that threshold of God's measurement. I declare that. We pass that threshold of measurement. There are millions of us. However, there are cities within our nation which may be at risk of not passing that measurement, especially the leaders of those cities. You notice that governor of Chicago, she's ready to open up those schools again. And she ordered those teachers back in. Of course, those teachers are in rebellion and stubbornness, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Certainly, if it pertains to leaders of cities, there are many. That order that came forward January the 3rd, where I was slain in the spirit, one of it was that Kumo would not repent, and that I pretty much to the effect that he was coming under God's judgment. Well, it looks like that judgment has begun, because even the Democrats are turning against him. So that looks like that has begun. And we're already seeing Ted Cruz becoming a voice for the people. He has been, I thought he was going to raise him up as his voice. And he has become a voice for the populace, for God's people, for God's word. And of course, we saw Josh Hawley go into all kinds of fire in that prophecy that came forth for him, but that he was going to come through, and God's hand was going to be mighty on him. He God had chosen him, in other words. So we need to pray for that man that he makes it.
Every one named after his neighbor's wife. I saw a
Do y'all feel that? Y'all feel like we've been steamrolled since the election? And when I saw that Reddit group gone in and did some damage to the hedge funds, I thought, well, God, you're moving for us. You're going to take back, you know, for the populace. So we're beginning to see movement of how God is going to deal with it. Okay, so now let's think about this a bit. If the jackal is the Federal Reserve, and it is seated in the president's seat, then wouldn't it be logical that the first thing to be hit with God's judgment would be finances,
mm-hmm.
which are controlled by the Federal Reserve,
mm-hmm.
which are massive. They control the World Bank,
mm-hmm.
if there is a World Bank that controls currencies. They control all of the currencies, really, of the United States, even though they're not officially a government agency. They sure do have a lot of power. I'm just thinking out loud. Okay.
I appointed a woman as director. I can't remember her name, but she's the head of the Federal Reserve. First woman to ever be the head of the Federal Reserve. She was on a previous director prior to that, but she's now the head of it.
Some reason God's drawing my attention to it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And since you can see why it would be good for him to do so, since I have no knowledge. I remember hearing a prophecy from Hank Kuhn during the time of the election of 2020 that the Lord would be fighting against the wickedness of the cities of the East Coast and West Coast with severe weather and winter storms. That California has had its second severe winter storm. Chicago's already second, and the third one's coming in.
And there's something about Highway 1 that has been wiped out in one place, so that you cannot drive from one border to the other of the United States.
That's just close.
Well, the Mud Squad took out.
Mud Squad,
yeah.
Highway 1.
Uh-huh. Okay, so the transportation system
that overlooks the Pacific Ocean.
Do not belong to the Lord.
Amen.
Now, some of them are hurt because what happened, but see, if they put their faith in the prophet's words, then they have put their faith in the prophet, not in the God of words. So he says, let what God says, let what they say be done to them. Now that is the word of the Lord. Okay, and God doesn't change, and his word doesn't change, and there is no shadow of turning in him. So I have been cautioning, and I'm telling these prophets, if you watch me on the altar, you be careful, don't put your tongue against God's anointing. Touch not my anointing, be my prophets no more. Okay, because see what's going to happen when God turns this thing around, and he will. Because of their belief and their faith in him, what they say is going to be turned on them.
Mm-hmm.
They'll fall into their own pit.
They will fall into their own pit. See, it's their pride and arrogance and their vain egos that is saying, well, those prophets don't know what they're talking about, because they don't want to appear foolish to their friends and to the world. They don't want to appear foolish to believe what the prophet said. Well, if you're going to walk with God, you have to get over not wanting to appear foolish. God will make you appear foolish just to break that stuff off of. Therefore, this is what the Lord God Almighty says. Because the people have spoken these words, I will make my words in your mouth of fire, and these people the wood it consumes. Okay, so now those prophets who have heard God through all of this that we've been through, and they've had to prophesy in the face of Satan coming in and saying, hey, we're going to squash your words. Your God is not going to win. We are going to make your words of no effect. Okay, so now what God will do after all of these prophets have manifested, after all these people have manifested, then God is going to make his prophets' mouth fire.
Hallelujah.
And that is the word of God. That's what God does. They have lied about God. And this is the standard human response to the long suffering of the Lord, is that, you know, God's not going to hurt us. You know, we can get by with anything. As Paul asked the Romans, do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness and tolerance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of God leads you to repentance? People, I stand amazed at Christians who push God's mercy and forgiveness without fear. I know people who have intentionally sinned. I'm talking about Christians who have been saved. They intentionally made up their mind to sin. And when they went into their sin, they say, well, God will forgive me, because he has forgiven me before. Did not keep forgetting before he will forgive me. Well, he will. But the time may come when he said, you no longer mind. When that just won't work anymore. Ephesians 17. O house of Israel, declares the Lord, I am bringing a distant nation against you. A lot of things that Robin says in there, he thinks we're going to have an attack. He thinks they're real fit. tell you what Satan had planned. There are prophets that would tell you what God had planned, and there are prophets who speak that set world events in motion. So, 18 through 19. Yet even in those days, declares the Lord, I will not destroy you completely. And when the people ask, why has the Lord our God done all this to us? You will tell them, as you have forsaken me and served foreign gods in your own land, so now you will serve foreigners in a land not your own. Last night, when I was typing this, I went to Facebook because I go back and forth and I put it on Facebook and I type, Doug Clinton, pastor in Missouri, that I know, Pastor Doug Clinton, had put up this picture of all this burning and everything in our city. And he said, these are people who have forsaken God. I just put this scripture right there on the top of it and forwarded it. God was just like speaking right into what I was doing last night. The Lord gives a divine pledge in the space of just 23 verses from in 427, 510, and 518. The destruction will not be complete. God remains mindful of his covenant commitment to his people, still feeling tenderness, even in the midst of stern correction and rebuke. Even in the prophet's darkest predictions and gloomiest moments, and we haven't seen some of the times of Israel went through, we've been just blessed and blessed and blessed. They retained the profound conviction that no matter how widespread the destruction is, a remnant will be left to form the nucleus of a better people, faithful in their allegiance to God. 20 through 25, because the victory's been won, he's coming back for a victorious and overcoming spotless church. Out of this crushing is going to come a day of glory. Now, another thing, like I said, I didn't listen to the end of that, but he said with the assignment of this invasion of this other nation, I need to clear that up. I don't think that it's going, God's going to allow it, because he said then there's going to be an invasion of God. I got to go back and listen to that, so I shouldn't be telling you what I haven't listened to the whole thing at the end. That there's going to be a great invasion of God's glory at the same time. That there is someone's going to try to invade our nation. Okay, 20 through 25. Announce this to the house of Jacob. Jenny, you heard that. Did you listen to the whole prophecy?
Robin Boyd?
Yeah.
Yes,
the end of it there about the invasion of God's glory. Last night I was listening to it and I didn't listen. I turned it off there at the very end because I thought I'd come back and listen to it today.
Okay, what part are you talking about?
About at the end when there would be an invasion of another nation, but that God, there's going to be an invasion of God's glory.
Right.
That's what he said.
He said the pattern was an invasion. After these three things, there would be, the country would be so devastated there would be an invasion by another country. That he said these three things can happen to the United States, but the invasion is going to be God.
Amen. Okay. I gotta go back and visit. That. All right, I have already had almost more than I can handle with the, this was 11:30 at night last night. Did I read 20 through 25? Announce this to the house of Jacob and proclaim it to Judah. Here it is, you foolish and senseless people, who have eyes. wrongdoings have kept these away. Your sins have deprived you of good. The greatness of God as creator, sustainer, giver, and avenger is contrasted with the meanness of man, which is really what Robert is talking about at the end there, where we're going to have an invasion of God. But these three things are going to happen, and I have to go back and pick that up. The sovereign God who set a boundary to the sea cannot be thwarted by man's wrong exercise of free will. This results in all kinds of sin, stubbornness, and hostility. Backsliding, lack of fear of God, and perversion of what is right. We have so much perversion of what is right. We have whole generations out there that don't even know what right is. They have no idea what right and wrong is. Okay, so I want y'all to hear this. The law concerning a stubborn and rebellious son, in Deuteronomy 21:18-21, was sentenced to death by stoning. Such a son was considered beyond hope. So how could this generation that Jeremiah's talking to, who was rebellious and stubborn, escape the penalty of death when God has charged them with stubbornness and rebellion? And the sentence is death. And they shall say unto the elders of this city, this our son is stubborn and rebellious. He will not obey our voice. He is a glutton and a drunkard. And all the men of his city shall stone him with stones that he die. So shall you put evil away from among you. And all Israel shall hear and fear. Aren't we glad we give him grace? Under the mercy of the Lord, Jesus Christ. Our sin still withholds good from the doer. But we see the seriousness of God's charge. He God charged them. He judged them. And then he sentenced them. Which is what Roman Roy said happened in that 2 minutes. Silence on inauguration day. He has judged them as stubborn and rebellious. Now I know people who boast of being stubborn and rebellious. They boast about it. But according to the Old Testament law, they must be punished. But because of his great love and covenant, he saves the remnant. Among my people are found wicked men. They lay wait, and he that sets snares, they set a trap, they catch men. As a cage is full of birds, so are their houses full of deceit. Therefore, they are become great and waxen rich. Now, I charge the FBI with this scripture. They set a trap for Trump. And people in his administration, they set a trap for him to catch them. So I charge the FBI and those who were behind it with this scripture. They have become great and waxen rich.
Yeah.
They are waxen fat. verses 30 through 31. A horrible and shocking thing has happened in the land. The prophets prophesied falsely, and the priests made a rule by their own authority. And my people love to have it so. And what will you do in the end thereof? Jeremiah declared judgment was now fully declared for corruption of conduct. The second reason was that they did not believe the message. And lastly, the final judgment was because of the revolting and rebellious heart of the people, stubborn and rebellious. Now you see how important it was with stubborn and rebellious. They could even stone a child, a son. They could stone someone who had, with a stubborn and rebellious heart. So here God has decreed, God has judged Israel, and their sin is stubbornness and rebellion.
That's right.
It came not a word of the Lord, and you have got the authority of the Lord to go forth. You don't give prophets in your congregation control of pulpit.
Amen. Amen.